Assalamu alaikum.
Y après ça vient ça.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد سلام جمعة مباركة The Honorable Professor Dr. Abdul Aziz Barghout Deputy Rector of IIUM Internationalization and Global Network as well as the Sheikhul Kuliah of the International Institute of Islamic Civilization and Malay World ISTAC, the Honorable Professor Dato' Dr. Osman Bakar, Distinguished Professor from Sultan Omar Ali Saifuddin Center for Islamic Studies, University Brunei Darussalam, the Honorable Associate Professor Dr. Hafiz Zakaria, the Acting Dean of ISTAC, the University Management Committee, and former heads of government agencies, distinguished guests and scholars, representatives of financial, youth, higher education institutes, agencies and foreign embassies, members of the media, IIM staff and students, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh, and a very good evening. Inshallah, we will start the program by reciting Suratul Fatiha. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahir Rabbil Alamin. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Shiratal mustaqim. Shiratal ladzina an'amta 'alayhim ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim waladdallin. Amin. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm welcoming all of you to the seminar on Islam, Democracy and the New Malaysia, which is organized by the International Institute of Islamic Civilization and Malay World ISTAC. For your information, earlier this morning, we have a good session, a good discussion with Prof. John L. Esposito. So now we are coming to the evening session featuring Professor Dato' Dr. Osman Bakar, a distinguished professor at Sultan Omar Ali Saifuddin Center for Islamic Studies, University Brunei Darussalam. And he will bring us further into the topic entitled Islam, Democracy and the New Malaysia, the relevance of Ibn Khaldun's theory of Asabiyah. So this is a very interesting topic which we will embark on this evening. Before that, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to call upon the Honorable Professor Dr. Abdul Aziz Barghout, Deputy Rector of Internationalization and Global Network, IIUM, to give his welcoming remark. Please.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, we are coming to the second session of our seminar today with our professor, Dato' Osman. I believe everybody knows who is Dato Osman Bakar, okay? So I think we are today receiving one of the great intellectuals of this Nusantara region in the areas of Islamic civilization, science, epistemology, and so on and so forth. Brothers and sisters, I think We are very, very honored to have Professor Osman with us here. As our MC mentioned, this morning we had Esposito, and now we are having Professor Osman Bakar talking about a very interesting topic. Islam, Democracy, and the New Malaysia, the relevance of Ibn Khaldun's theory of Asabiya. I believe this is one of the very important topics, and I hope everybody, inshallah, will participate and will, because we allocated around 1 hour for debate, discussions, questions, and answers, and I hope we benefit and seize this opportunity to learn more and to benefit from our professor today. In the end, ISTEC would like to thank Professor Osman for accepting our invitation, and this is our effort in ISTEC to make sure that we create a new platform in this institute to generate more discussions and ideas for the benefit of Malaysia and the Ummah at large. With this, once again, I thank all the participants who were here this morning, and you are still here with us, and this is really great, and I think you don't see this type of an audience in many other places and conferences, where people, when they finish their papers, they leave. But here, we did it by purpose. It was a very kind of a special program. People are selected and invited one by one to have this intellectual debate and intellectual discussions, inshallah. With this, I thank you all, and I think we will hand over to Sister Professor Camarunia to also moderate this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Aziz and MC. So, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah, we are here again, and we will continue with this. If just now I had great pleasure introducing Professor Esposito, who's actually a big brother, we call the siblings of Temple University. So also is Prof. Osman Bakar. Prof. Osman Bakar is a very special person. He made me what I am today, believe you. Had it not been for him, obviously just be at my BA degree. I just got into that mood. But he helped and he developed and he pushed. But he never threatened. He's not the type of person, you know, who's another one of my great professors here. So my success is his story of pushing me forward. And he is born into this ability to motivate. And I have some of his students here are making headlines, even this great Professor Aslam is, in a way, motivated by Prof. Osman Bakar. So he's not just a scholar for many of us. Okay? So even so, we would like Prof, to welcome Prof. I will just read. Again, as I said, you have to bear with me. I am focal blind on my left eye, a bad reader. But we have a great man here, so it's okay. Osman Bakar, or Prof. Osman Bakar, is currently Distinguished Professor at the Sultan Omar Ali Sharifuddin Center of Islamic Studies, SOASIS, University of Brunei Darussalam, and Emeritus Professor of Philosophy of Science at the University of Malaya. Obviously, this is not a Malaysian who wrote this. Dr. Bakar, Dr. Osman Bakar, that was his father. If you say Dr. Bakar in Malay, it's his father. Prof. Osman Bakar was formerly the Deputy CEO of Kuala Lumpur-based think tank, the International Institute of Advanced Islamic Studies, ISIS, the Deputy Vice Chancellor on Academic and Research University of Malaya, and that's when he made his name, the Professor at the International Institute of Islamic Thought and Civilization, is one of us, coming back home, of IIUM. He's a senior fellow at the Prince Al-Walid Center for Muslim Christian Understanding, Georgetown, Washington, Georgetown University, Washington, and visiting fellow, research fellow at Doshisha University, Japan, Kyoto, formerly the holder of the Malaysia Chair of Islam in Southeast Asia at Georgetown University. Prof. Osman Bakar was educated in London University, where he obtained his Bachelor of Science and Master of Science in Mathematics. Remind me of somebody who got his first degree in philosophy and become a banker. He earned his doctorate. I was amazed. I said, how did you come to be what you are from philosophy? This is introducing our great Tantri, okay? He earned his doctorate in Islamic philosophy from Temple University, Philadelphia. A Fulbright visiting scholar at Harvard University, 1992, he has published 20 books and more than 300 articles on Islamic thought and civilization, particularly Islamic philosophy and science, and on contemporary Islam, interreligious and intercivilizational dialogues. The founder of the Center for Civilization of Dialogue at University of Malaya, that's him. Prof. Osman has also served as advisor and consultant to various international academic and professional organizations, institutes, including UNESCO and Qatar Foundation. He was a member of C100, Council of 100 Leaders of West Islamic World Initiative for Dialogue, established by the World Economic Forum based in Switzerland. He was awarded a datukship by the Sultan of Pahang, 1994, and another datukship by the Malaysian King, Agong, 2000. Prof. Osman's best-known works are Tauhid and Science, a Classification of Knowledge in Islam, and Islam and Civilizational Dialogue. The first two books have been published in a number of Muslim languages, including Persian, Turkish, Indonesian, and Albania. Several of his other writings have also been translated into Spanish, Chinese, Urdu, Arabic, and Bosnian. In 2009, Prof. Osman Bakar was included in the list of Malaysia's 20 leading intellectuals. He has been named several times since 2010 among the 500 most influential Muslims in the world, and including in the latest edition, 2017. So brothers and sisters, we know him, now you know him even more. So welcome. Bismillah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam. Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, big sister. Come on, yeah. It's also big brother. Why you tell me big brother? I told big sister. Thank you very much, Istek, for inviting me to this very, very interesting one-day seminar with my colleague, Professor John Esposito. And nice to be back at STEC. The last time I was here in this building, this grand building, was in 2011, if I'm not mistaken, when I was teaching two courses here. I was no longer staff of STEC at that time. I left in 2008, but I continue to teach the postgraduate students here. My talk this morning, I'm sharing the same main title with John Esposito, Islam, Democracy, and the New Malaysia, whatever that means, but with different subtitles. John Esposito's subtitle was Prospects and Challenges in the New Era of Malaysia. And my subtitle is The Relevance of Ibn Khaldun's Theory of Ansabiyah. I know in this hall, in this room right now, there are several people who are more knowledgeable than me about Ibn Khaldun, including Brother Esmawi, who comes from the birthplace of Ibn Khaldun himself. What can I do? Yeah? When you have a scholar, Ibn Khaldun, and I'm never so next to me is the holder of the Ibn Khaldun chair. Yeah? So, but it's true, I know some people here who are knowledgeable about Ibn Khaldun. Now, back to the main title of the lecture, Islam, Democracy, and the New Malaysia. There are three terms here. Islam, democracy, and the new Malaysia. Among the three terms, I think the term Islam, I'm more familiar. I think I know more of the three terms than the other two. This morning, Sister Kamal Onia asked for a definition of democracy from Professor John Esposito. And he answered correctly that there are so many definitions of democracy. In one sense, democracy is a vague term. For logicians, for people who are very want to be very careful about the use of words, well, we say it can mean anything. I agree, you say that it's quite difficult, really, to be precise about the term democracy. But then, that should not be taken as an obstacle to us. It's something good. That because what it means is that, if that is the case, then we Malaysians are free to shape to shape the kind of democracy that we want for Malaysia, that we think would be good for Malaysia. It is an open concept, an open question, unless you belong to the philosophers' circle, because the philosophers will try to define what is democracy. Democracy etymologically means the rule of man. That is what democracy means, the rule of man. And therefore, those who want to talk about theocracy, the rule of God, this is something different. Yeah? But as we listened this morning to the lecture by Dr. John Esposito, I think it's not so much going into that philosophical definition. Although I'm very much in love philosophy, I like philosophy, but for the purpose today, I'm not going to talk philosophically, because philosophically I can say, well, yes, it's true. Why is Islam? Is Islam a democracy or a theocracy? Personally, answer, it is both. If by theocracy means the rule of God, then definitely there is a part of Islam. By means that we have to live in accordance with God as prescribed for us. But then, God has also given us freedom. That's very important. God has given as Khalifa. As Khalifa, we are given the freedom to do what we think is best for us, the human species, on this planet Earth, our temporary planet, our temporary home. Yeah. So, just in the case of Islam, it's both theocracy and democracy, if you go by that definition. But we are not discussing that today. Yeah? Basically, like what Esposito, yeah? Of course, I consider John Esposito as my professor, as a subject of Islam and democracy is concerned. He has written so much. Yeah? I haven't written a single book about Islam and democracy. I do talk, but I haven't written any book on that. But he has written books on that. So still, I would say that I know more about Islam than about democracy. But this last term, the new Malaysia, is even worse. What do you mean by the, I don't know. I don't know. What do you mean by this new Malaysia? Yeah? If by new Malaysia you mean the Malaysia that is ruled by the new government, the PH, the Pakatan Harapan, then it's only 70 days old. It's just still a baby. Still a baby. How can about a baby? What is going to be the future of this baby? Yeah, I don't know what this baby is going is going to be. But anyway, it's interesting. I'm interested to know about what is this new Malaysia, the new baby is. So that comes in my subtitle, The subtitle is the relevance of Ibn Khaldun's theory of Ansabiyya. I'm hoping, I'm depending on relying on Ibn Khaldun to help me, to talk about this new Malaysia. How can I want, what is the point? I mean, what's the rationale of me trying to get the help from Ibn Khaldun, who lived 600 years ago, about 600 years ago now, Mr. Ibn Khaldun, Sheikh Ibn Khaldun, to help us in discussing about Islam and democracy and the new Malaysia. He lived 600 years old, yeah? And the new Malaysia is yet to grow, is yet to develop. But then, this is where the importance of Ibn Khaldun is. Because according to Ibn Khaldun, history repeats itself. History is cyclic. It is not linear, as believed by so many historians, by so many scholars in the West. History is not linear. Progress is not linear. It's always cyclic. Precisely because it's cyclic, what if Ibn Khaldun observes about the phenomena of Ansabiyya in the Muslim world of his time has repeated itself and it is still relevant to us? Later I'll say something about this, the relevance of Ibn Khaldun's theory. But let me go back still to the subtitle and the main title. If you are given these three words, Islam, democracy, and the new Malaysia. Okay, discuss it. So what do you want to discuss? I suppose different people will approach the title from different angles, from different perspectives. But I just want to raise this point because I know I've heard people raising this question in Malaysia. He said, will Islam be better off in the new Malaysia or will it be worse off? I don't know whether you, someone in the hall, you have heard this question. I've heard. In fact, I'll come to that. So that's one question. Will Islam be better off in the new Malaysia or will it be worse off? Another question, also many are asking, will democracy be better off in the new Malaysia or will it be worse off? Now, the new Malaysia means in the sense that we already, it means just simply that under the new Pakatan Harapan government. Yet another question that, especially for those who have been thinking aloud or not so aloud about the state of relationship between Islam and democracy in the contemporary Islamic world, like this Dr. John Esposito, he considers himself to be expert on the subject of Islam and democracy in the Muslim world, including in Southeast Asia. So, the question is, will there be a welcome synergy under the new Pakatan Harapan government? Will there be a new synergy between Islam and democracy, which somehow, something that was dormant in the old administration, in the BN administration, but now this synergy will be released, will be opened up because of new approaches. That's very, it's interesting to find out. Certainly, I think there will be a new synergy, precisely because the emphasis of the new administration will be on the more universal dimension of Islam, not on the exclusive dimension of Islam, because every religion is both inclusive and exclusive. Islam is no different. Islam is both. It's just that among all religions, in the case of Islam, it possesses a wider, broader dimension of that inclusive dimension compared to other religions. Yeah? So in the case of Islam, I'm claiming here that Islam is the most inclusive of all religions. Yeah? That can be discussed later. Yeah. So the point is that of this new synergy, between anti-Islam and democracy, you can expect to have that. You can expect to have that. But anyway, based on what we know now, what we read, what we hear, especially since 9 May, since that, a lot of questions are being raised. So there are also conflicting responses to this question. For example, the question number one, which I posed to John, will Islam be better off? I said, well, I mean, actually, even before the election, before the victory of the PA's government, some people already made up their mind. Yes, you see, Islam is going to be worse off, not better off. Why? Because they understand Islam according to certain perspective, according to certain definitions. They have the idea. So that's why, for example, I observe that, okay, until the appointment of the minister in charge of the religious affairs in the Prime Minister's department, before, until that time, some people have been asking, look, this new government doesn't talk about Islam at all. No reference to Islam at all. All talking about neighbors, about, of course, most important is OMDB, about the debt. So that's what I said. But to say that, because Mahathir and his cabinet only speaking about these things and not Islam per se, because the word Islam is not mentioned, then they make the conclusion that this new government is not concerned with Islam. But then if we understand the teachings of Islam as a whole, now, and we ask ourselves, is the concern with corruption, as there's nothing to do with Islam? No. Just look at hadith, the collection of hadith on corruption. I mean, where corruption stands? It is against the religion. The question of debt, to settle debt, the country is in debt. Is that with Islam? Just look again. Is it good to be in debt personally at the level of the individuals? No, it is not good. We want to be in debt. Yeah. Well, this is my point. The question now: your perspective of what Islam stands for. Is it only Islam is there because you talk about Islam? You mention explicitly the word Islam, but the moment you don't mention the word Islam, then it's nothing to do with Islam. This is our problem as a student of philosophy. As a student of philosophy, a problem because a lot of things, I don't find Islam mentioned in these books by the Muslim philosophers, by Al-Farabi, Zed. You're looking for Islam. Very, I don't find the word, the Quranic verses being mentioned in the book, no citation of Quranic verses and so on. Yes, that is another approach. In others, the philosophers, yeah, the philosophers, actually, my own study of philosophy is that the philosophers actually did talk about the teachings of Islam, but their approach is different. It's different from the theologians, from the fuqaha. They don't go every now and then. They must cite where the Quran says, where the hadith says. No, I mean, because they have a different approach. So I think that's what's going to happen. Yeah. So still early to say, because still a baby. Yeah. But this baby is going to cause a lot of surprises later on as it's growing up. So that's the first thing. Same thing with the question. The other question: will democracy be better off? In a sense, it's difficult. Difficult to be precise to answer that question. It depends what you mean by democracy. But to be honest, our understanding of democracy is not deep. Most people. Because democracy, if you go by the democracy is not merely going to the polls every 5 years, cast your ballot. It's not just having parliament where you have a chit chat. It's not parliament, it's just not that, yeah? Or what the Agon says, sit down, don't run away. It's parliament, it's much more than that. This is where it's important. I mean, the discourse. We are hoping that the discourse about democracy will be more vibrant, the discourse. That's important. We hope that there will be a new environment, an intellectual environment in which we can talk big ideas, talk about big ideas within democracy, knowing that there's no model. There's no model of democracy today. In fact, lately, there are problems for American democracy and for European democracy. Yeah. So we have a chance to prove that there is another approach, an alternative to democracy. Yeah. So some people in the West are not asking the question, what can we learn from Malaysia? And it's discussed this morning. Yes, yeah, I think you, Stephen, people interested, approach you. What can we learn from Malaysia? Okay, the other one, of course, the relationship between democracy and Islam. That relationship. What relationship does Islam has with democracy? My own understanding of Islam and democracy is that, and we discussed later, even under the topic of Ansabiyah, that Islam has the teaching, has the treasury of ideas which will enable it to refine democracy. Islam is able to provide ideas and values that will refine democracy, that will give meaning and content to democracy in a more comprehensive way, which the West itself is still looking for. So I think that is important. So Islam as a source of empowerment of democracy. Okay, I want to go now to the relevance of Ibn Khaldun's theory of Ansabiyah. The relevance and what it is relevant. I consider Ibn Khaldun as an expert on even the new Malaysia. To me, Ibn Khaldun's concept of Ansabiyah is relevant to our attempt to answer the questions that I have posed just now. Right? Will Islam be better? Will democracy be better off? Will the relationship between Islam and democracy be better off? I find that by studying Ibn Khaldun's theory of Ansabiyah, we may come across perspectives, ideas, concepts that will help us to understand even this new baby. Don't have to wait for long, precisely based on what history has taught us. History has taught us. So I'm saying Ibn Khaldun's concept of Ansabiyah is useful even if we are to understand the dynamics of Islam and democracy in Malaysia, the old and the new, not just the new Malaysia. In fact, in order to understand the new Malaysia, we have to understand also, do not forget, the old Malaysia. It's continuity. There is both continuity and discontinuity. Accordingly, I will explain what Ansabiyah means according to Ibn Khaldun and in what way his theory is relevant to the issue of relationship between Islam and democracy. Before I proceed to explain what Ibn Khaldun's theory of Ansabiyah is all about, some of you know, I know this very well, but at least before I try to explain it. I would like to emphasize two things here. First, I'm maintaining that Ibn Khaldun's theory of Asadia is of great relevance to modern issues of interest groups. Because in our time, there are so many interest groups, so many organizations. I did not have the time to check with the Registrar of Societies how many, right now, how many societies, organizations are registered. Anybody know? Anybody in the room who can tell me with what the letters? But it's a lot. Yes. So many. Yeah. It's so many. Not so many during the Ansabi groups during Ibn Khaldun's time. But why? I mean, it is relevant to the concept of interest groups. So many interest groups. Is this also important? Relevant to the issue of sectarianism, which is important to our contemporary society, extremism, and of course, the common good, the idea of the common good. The common good. Human cooperation, concept of human cooperation, and the concept of civilizational progress and decline. Progress as well as decline. The progress, the rise of dynasty. The decline of dynasty. But dynasty, here, for our times, you have to look for equivalent terms, something to do with ruling power, the ruling power. So, in that sense, the Barisan Nasional, which lost the election, they ruled Malaysia for 60 years or so. So how they fit in into the idea or concept of dynasty of Ibn Khaldun? That's important. Yeah. Now, the second point that I want to emphasize here is that because I'm now speaking here at STEC, I think I want to emphasize the importance of including Ibn Khaldun's theory of Ansabiyya in civilizational studies, in studies of civilization as such, not Islamic civilization simply, or Christian civilization, or Chinese civilization, but civilization, human civilization as such. We must have that. So particularly as postgraduate center, like ISTEC, we must study Ansabiyya as part of civilizational studies. And since this Ansabiyya is related to political thought, I think it is very important that political thought be made a very important aspect of Islamic civilization, which we have not done. Somehow, but how can we exclude political thought from the study of civilization, especially Islamic civilization? We hope that the newly resurrected ISTEC, so nowadays many things are resurrected. So we hope, inshallah. Now, for my presentation, so basically I want to answer the questions that I have posed with the help of the idea of Ansabiyya as defined and formulated by Ibn Khaldun. Meaning of Ansabiyya. Now, most of us, often I know many Malays, refer to Ansabiyya. They refer to the meaning of Ansabiyya that is contains an objective, objectionable meaning, because it's mentioned in the hadith, There are several hadith related to this, what is, has been understood as prohibiting Ansabiyya. The short one, for example, this one, the formula one, At-ta'asub wal-ansabiyya, tafarq wa jahiliyya, and the other one, Laysa minna man da'ila ansabiyya, wa laysa minna man qatala ala ansabiyya, وَلِسَ مِنَّا مَنْ مَعَتَ عَلَى أَسَبِيَّةِ. This is the text of the hadith. This the first one, fanaticism and tribalism and factionalism, is a characteristic of the age of ignorance of Jalia, or some translation have the characteristic of paganism. Characteristic of paganism. The other one, he said, he is not one of us who calls to Ansabiya, and he is not one of us who fights for Ansabiya, and he is not one of us who dies in the path of Ansabiya or for Ansabiya. So clearly there is against religion, against the teachings of religion. But Ibn Khaldun knew this, of course he knew this hadith. Yeah? He knew this hadith. So when he knew this hadith, and yet he wants to come up with a new conception of Asabiya, you mean to say that he doesn't know Arabic? That's the problem. I mean, he's an Arab. Yeah? He knows. Yeah? In other words, from the point of linguistic validity, even to come up this with from the word Asaba, related to the word Isaba, or he mentioned in the Quran, Asba, the plural form, Asba. Yeah? Now, he knew that. But now the genius of Ibn Khaldun is precisely that, how can he create a theory which can comprehend even this the meaning that is opposed to religion? That's the thing. And he came out of a beautiful theory. It goes back to human nature. It goes back to human nature. Psychology, he went back to sociology and psychology. Socio-psychology. Could go to the study of human nature. Not simply individual human nature, but what is the nature of human being collectively speaking in terms of the human organization. So I think this is where the theory is important, is that he's just simply saying Ansabiya is referring to an aspect of human nature, according to which human beings have natural tendency to form group, to be associated with group and session. And that's why did Allah Ta'ala, why did God give that nature to human beings? Because human being has to play the role of Khalifa on earth, not individually, but collectively. So, therefore, human being can only develop this tendency if it is already present there in the first place in human nature. I think it's very important. This is where the importance of the Islamic Sharia is. God prescribed his Sharia not against nature, but in accordance with human nature. Islam is based on the nature of things. Islam is based on the nature of things. So that whatever he asks us to do is in accordance with our human nature. And in this case, it's about the nature from group. So basically, we need to ask, okay, if that is the text, the hadith text, what is the context in which we should understand that prohibition? The context is, I can mention another way, one is the purpose. For what purpose do you have that Ansabiya? You develop the Ansabiya for what purpose? And what is the content of that Ansabiya? The Ansabiya must have content. To serve what? The Ansabiya is to serve an instrument. It is an instrument to help human being to achieve higher things until even up to create civilization. You cannot create civilization without Ansabiya. That is very, very, very important, but not the negative Ansabiya. So that's why now, if you talk about the theory of Ansabiya according to Ibn Khaldun, first of all, there is the objectionable Ansabiya, the blameworthy Ansabiya of the Jahili type. This is the group sentiment or group solidarity that denies a higher moral purpose. See? Simply, yes, the group sentiment, group solidarity, but what is the purpose? No purpose. It denies or it is not subjected to a higher moral purpose. It is blind support of one's group without regard to the justice of its cause. the philosophy of right or wrong, my tribe, right or wrong, my race, right or wrong, my country, and so on. That is not the answer. You have the group solidarity that is advocated by Islam. So more generally, we are speaking here in this context of asabiyah and understanding asabiyah that goes against religion. But there is another kind of asabiyah, the praiseworthy asabiyah, the positive social factor that gives rise to civilization. Okay? And in this sense, Ibn Khaldun was not the first to speak of asabiyah with a positive meaning. He was not the first. There were all the fellow historians like Ibn al-Athir. But still, you cannot take away the novelty of Ibn Khaldun's theory, because in terms of the scope, in terms of the scope of that asabiyah, it is, he went far beyond any of the other scholars before him. Yeah. So in this case, asabiyah that is not opposed to religion or that can serve religion. Now let me some highlight. I hope and I'm get to carry it away. 20 minutes. Okay, I'm sure that. Yeah. Okay, let me now, because I want to talk about the new Malaysia. Okay, now let us give some highlights. I just want to mention highlights of Ibn Khaldun's theory of asabiyah. First thing that I want to highlight. There are different types of asabiyah. You see, Shao, he goes now going to analysis. He's not simply talking asabiyah and then condemn asabiyah. No, this is different. See? After all, Ibn Khaldun was a social scientist, explained social science, the founder of social science. And I thought, okay, he observed the phenomena of asabiyah. He said, there are different types of asabiyah. First, the classification of types of asabiyah based, or rather, is determined by the nature of the bond or binding force that holds a group together. That's why we have different types of asabiyah, because different types of bond linking members of the group. Of course, for Ibn Khaldun, especially during this time, the most popular, the most visible kind of bond is blood ties. Blood ties. Because they are nearest to us. Our parents, our brothers, sisters, our uncle, aunts, and cousins, and so on. And then you create your own clan, right? So it's family relationship based on blood ties. So it is there. That is the first type of asabiyah. You show you're closer to these people because we have blood ties. But the other one, a kind of extension of the family ties, is ethnic ties. Ethnic ties. So we have clan, tribe, race. In the case of some regions like Judaism, because it's a race-based religion, there's another kind of asabiyah based on religion, race-based religion. So you can have that. So you can have some Arab, Malay Arabs, originate from whatever, you know, this from Yemen, Hadramaut. Okay, that then you have the clan, the Hadramaut clan, and they are attached to others. That is a sense of certain asabiyah. But even then, there's themselves, as our professor Sa'adi can tell you, what is meant to belong to the Aidi clan. Eh? Yeah. So you have your own asabiyah. Yeah. But that's the good asabiyah is nothing, because it is natural to be attached to people whom you baptize. Yeah. But Ibn Khaldun also talks about kind of other than blood ties. Blood other than blood ties, something with what we mean is that abstract ties, abstract ideological ties. Yeah, ideological relationship. We have, and even during Ibn Khaldun's time, there was already this. Yeah. So in our, of course, in our contemporary world, we have what is called based on common interest. Yeah, based on common interest. Now this is what we have. Professional ties. So the engineers, we get together among the engineers. So they have the engineers have their own asabiyah. The architects have their own asabiyah. The bankers have their own asabiyah. Yeah. Of course, you have to do, sorry? Philosophers, not so sure. Yeah, they can be very individualistic. But you're right, in the case of Islam, as Ibn Khaldun referred, he did not, I mean, use the word that, but of course, when it refers to different schools of thought, you know, different schools of thought, among the philosophers, among the mutakallimun, the theologians, they all have their, you know, their own being drawn closer towards their kind. So, yes, you have asabiyah based on professional commonality, and then of course you have the based on religion. Asabiyah based on religion, and also within the same religion, among the madhab, right? So that the Sunnis have great affinity, you know, with fellow Sunnis, and the Shi'i among the Shi'is. So that is within religion, and also if you want to go into the schools of fiqh, of jurisprudence, yeah, you have that kind of affinity there. But even finally, Ibn Khaldun's concept of Ansabiyah will go to the extent of civilization. You're talking about the most comprehensive social organization possible. That is at the level of culture, of civilization. So not civilization is normally viewed by scholars of civilization as an extension of religion. Only during the modern time that we have the modern civilization that does not have religion as its core. But all pre-modern civilization have religion as the core or the heart. So there's different types of ansabiyah determined by the nature of the bond. But there's another type of ansabiyah which is determined by the field of cultural activity or civilization activity. For example, I can say political ansabiyah. Ansabiyah is political in nature. So the ansabiyah, the Amno ansabiyah, that is political ansabiyah. The PKR ansabiyah, if they have, or the whatever it is, or the DAP ansabiyah, the MIC ansabiyah. So this is political ansabiyah. Yeah, there's a certain element, certain things that bind the members of that group together. The other one is a religious ansabiyah, so there's another kind of classification. Although it's not explicitly mentioned, but implicit, yes, in Ibn Khaldun's time, even then, you have the economic ansabiyah. Economic ansabiyah. Even during that time, talking about the 15th century, 14th century, 15th century, because at that time, for example, in Islam, there already existed the Sufi guilds. You have Chinese guilds. What is basically Chinese guild? What sort of asabiyah is Chinese guild? It's partly economic. Because each guild, Chinese guild, organized its economic activities based on clan. But the Sufi guilds, then is the Turuk ansabiyah, the tariqah ansabiyah. So that some tariqah, in other words, they have their own, what do you call this, business thing. Yeah? They used to say, okay, one tariqah, you know, they specialize on all the carpets, thing. You know, that was true before. Of course, the modern type of Asabiya that we have even now based on the gender Asabiya. You know what I mean? You know what I mean?
Yes.
Oh yeah. Among the women, among the men, or the not in between, no. So the no, even the LGBT, they have their own Asabiya, no. Very powerful. The LGBT Asabiya is a very powerful Asabiya.
See?
Powerful and very persistent. Sorry? How do I know that? I study Asabiya phenomena. Following Ibn Khaldun. You will learn. You will come to know. And therefore, be concerned. Okay, this is types of Asabiya as determined by the field of cultural activity. That is the second point I want to add. The third point is about what I call the plurality and diversity of Asabiya. This is very important. This thing is observed. Well observed by Ibn Khaldun on this thing, plurality and diversity of Asabiya, which I can say is Asabiya pluralism. It is Asabiya pluralism. What sorts of things did Ibn Khaldun observe? According to Ibn Khaldun, actually, you have been telling according to Ibn Khaldun, not according to Osman Bakar. No? Ibn Khaldun, what was I interpreting? Yeah. The Asabiya exists according to different strengths. The idea of Asabiya have different strengths. The Asabiya of one group may not be as strong as the Asabiya of another group. Yeah? So some Asabiyas are stronger or more preponderant than others. Some Asabiya are more predominant in influence, in number, or importance. How you get to that, of course, you have to follow the dynamics of social development. You have to follow that. Okay? Now, another observation about this Asabiya pluralism, there is such a thing as exclusive Asabiya. If we started from the idea that Asabiya is already exclusive, is it correct to be to know? In other words, every to a certain extent, yes, of course, because that is by definition. Asabiya is by definition exclusive. But then that is not the whole thing. It's not the whole thing. Yeah? So for exclusive, because there is also the inclusive Asabiya. So there is exclusive Asabiya and there is inclusive Asabiya. Now, what do you mean by exclusive Asabiya? Is that Asabiya which lacks interest or spirit of intergroup cooperation for the common good. That's what I mean by exclusive Asabiya. That group not interested in having cooperation with other groups for common interest. Just like to be on their own or something like that. Yeah? As far as possible, just not to be involved. With it very good. But what's important from the Ibn Khaldun is this inclusive Asabiya, because that is related to civilization. So what do you mean by inclusive Asabiya? It is the presence of spirit of intergroup cooperation for the common good. When, yes, you have a group, let's say, just for the sake of discussion, I mean, your clan, the ID clan, and then we'll say what? Another clan?
Al-Atas
clan, okay. Al-Atas clan, yeah. Yeah, no. All right, as clans, I mean, you have that. Yeah? You stick in some to your own clan. But since we live in a society where, even according to our religion, that we need to cooperate with each other on matters of common interest, and therefore you show that interest. So that's the meaning of inclusive asabiyah here. I mean, to be concerned with intergroup cooperation for the sake of the common good. And what the common good means that changes from one situation to another, the idea of the common good. And when it comes to civilization, that is the highest common good. That is the broadest common good possible than civilization. So Ibn Khaldun argues that this type of asabiyah is an important factor in the rise and development of civilization. The other point is competition among existing asabiyah. Don't think there is no competition. There is competition. Yeah? Different groups with their respective asabiyah, they compete against each other. Depending on what the political asabiyah will compete. If that political group is interested in political power, you have to compete. How can you win without competition? Even the economic one, you have to compete. The different clans have to compete. Different guilds have to compete. Okay. But also within the same asabiyah. There's also competition within the same asabiyah. Within Amno asabiyah, there's so many sub-asabiyah groups. Yeah. That's why you have the role of the family. The role of leading families in political asabiyah. And it's something happening in the world. It's not unique to Islam or anything like that. America, look at America. The asabiyah, political asabiyah based on family. So the Bushes, the Kennedys, they belong to that time. Yeah. And then the predominance of asabiyah is related, this question, how does a group asabiyah become predominant? It is related to the question of inclusivity. The more inclusive that group, then the more predominant it becomes. That's a very interesting observation. And then, of course, the quality of leadership. With better quality in leadership, then that asabiyah becomes more influential, more predominant. And, of course, the criteria of the quality of leadership, what is a good leadership, the criteria, the meaning of good leadership that changes over history. So if you look at Hans Tuah Stein, then of course, when you talk about good leadership means, I mean, you must have good in Bersilat, kan? But to say that now, in our time now, that is a criteria, that is absurd. Yeah? Now it's more on base knowledge leadership. So asabiyah is related to the question of political power. But anyway, competition among asabiyah is an ongoing social phenomenon. It was there during Ibn Khaldun's time, and it is still now. Now, next point, the highlight of Ibn Khaldun's theory of asabiyah is the link between asabiyah and civilization, which Ibn Khaldun used the word umran. Umran, so begin with asabiyah, with the minimum level of asabiyah, but under good leadership, being more inclusive, knowledge base, and so on, and good family and pedigree. Yeah? So, yes, it goes to create civilization. But civilization presupposes human cooperation in the pursuit of the common good. So, for asabiyah, to be in the service of civilization is not, it needs more. More things are needed in order for an asabiyah to rise to that status. We're going to be the dominant group in civilization. That's why in history, and Ibn Khaldun is a good historian, he observed that, I mean, from low level of tribal leadership, how can finally becomes the ruler of a dynasty and so on. I think that's important. But then also a question of decline of asabiyah. So the decline. People talk nowadays about in Malaysia about the decline of Warisan Nasional. I mean, how valid it is to talk about decline. But anyway, decline also beyond that. And it's interesting that for Ibn Khaldun, he made some observation about this decline, the rise or decline of Masabiya. Then the, for example, when a particular Ansabiya had reached the status of a ruling power, ruling, how can that ruling power decline? He mentions two things, luxury and corruption. Luxury and corruption. That's basically kind of universal, Sufyan Mina. He makes that universal on the way. How come a dynasty in power then become, then lost the power, is because indulgence over time in luxury and in corruption. In fact, overall, I think Ibn Khaldun is saying, although he gave a specific example, that civilization corrupts. Very interesting. It's very interesting because normally for us, when we say we need to be civilized, we want to become civilized. And we always equate civilization with civilized being making progress. But Ibn Khaldun say that is not necessarily so. The first thing to get corrupted in a civilization is language. Any language here? It's language, language. It's very interesting. When you get more civilized, your language to become more and more corrupted. So your passer will become more important than your literary, the Malay. So you become more civilized, but you speak more pasar, right? Yeah, you speak the market, yeah. Yes. So very, very interesting. You like, you know? That's, if you can do, that's the first thing. So even during the time of the prophet, when you go to the best Arabic, where do you go? You go to the Bedouin. Not in the city of Mecca. So this is very interesting. But another interesting thing is the lifespan of a dynasty or in power, no more than three generations. Three generations or four generations. Three generations. Three generations is what? It's 90 years. Yeah. So according to Ibn Khaldun, that. So those now who are get excited of writing of Amno, of writing obituary for Amno, wait a minute, according to Ibn Khaldun, of course, I mean the Amno Asabiya can appear in another form, can appear, that's why I think Dr. Mahathir is thinking that Parti Bersatu will come to replace Amno, because the Amno has lost that original pure Asabiya of the of the Malay Asabiya. But observation of Ibn Khaldun, that's it. So especially if you're speaking about politics. Can I have a few minutes more? Now, so anyway, I just want, with regard to the highlights of Ibn Khaldun, I just want to make some important conclusions of observations. As I see it, Ibn Khaldun's Ansabiya strikes a balance, a middle ground between individualism and collectivism of the communist style, which is very much in line with the wasatiya philosophy advocated by Islam. The debate in philosophy, in political philosophy and so on, the role of individualism. There's a lot of critics of Western individualism and Eastern collectivism, as for example, under Mao Zedong, to the extent that, you should wear the same kind, of dress and so on. And that's leveling off, a kind of leveling society with no hierarchy at all. Everything is leveling. But the other one is individualism. So Asabiya that is conceived, talked about by Ibn Khaldun, is in between. by giving a positive role to Asabiyah. Asabiyah is not necessarily bad, depending on the objective, the purpose of the Asabiyah, what are sort of things, you know, that go with it. To me, that's the observation that I would like to make, that meets the ground. And then I think Asabiyah is not going to disappear as a social phenomenon. It's not going to disappear. Why? Because it is based on human nature. Asabiyah is not going to disappear. So when I heard LGE, Lim Guan Eng, when he said, I'm not Chinese, I'm a Malaysian. As a scholar, I don't agree with him. I would say, why don't you say I'm Chinese? I'll go, oh, yes, I accept you as a Chinese. I said, but of course, you're also a Malaysian. This question of multiple identity. You don't just got to go for one identity. My Singapore friends also, I mean, long time ago, asking this about the identity of being Muslim in the context of Singapore, because Singapore wants to promote unity. He wants to promote the idea of you're Malay, you're Muslim, you're Christian, and Confucian, and so on. Therefore, that will undermine that the idea of national unity. I don't think so. I think multiple identity can be a positive factor. It depends on how we approach it, how we deal with it. Yeah? So we can have. Going back to Sayyidina Omar in Khattab, he, as a clan, he belongs to Adi clan. He belongs to Quraysh tribe. Belongs to Arab in terms of race. Muslim as, you know, as civilization, as, you know. So you can have different that. So I can say I am a Pahang person. That's one identity. Although much doesn't mean much nowadays. I don't have Asabiyah with her anymore. Yeah? we come from both from Pahang. Yeah, but it doesn't mean much nowadays. That's it. But I mean, it is true. I can speak of that identity. I can speak of identity. I'm Malay. I can speak of identity. I'm Muslim. I'm Malaysian. I'm ASEAN. Yeah, and so on. Yeah, I think there's somehow this tendency among some people. Just okay, we just only go for one identity, whatever. Yeah, whereas I think it makes us richer if we talk about our multiple identity. So that kind. Yeah? So, but another thing, of course, the idea of plurality and diversity of Asabiyah, as discussed by Ibn Khaldun, may be viewed as the rules of modern democracy. This is for our students. Please study this issue. The Asabiyah of Ibn Khaldun has not yet been studied. I don't know, I may be wrong. But if I didn't know real study. In discussing as the rules of modern democracy. Yes, about the rules of modern sociology, the founder of modern sociology, economics, and so on, but not democracy. Yeah, I think we need to find the rules of modern Western democracy in Ibn Khaldun as well. There's a lot of Asabiyah in American democracy. A lot, especially during election. The presidential candidates will go for the Irish votes, the Jewish votes, the Muslim votes, the Hispanic votes, the Italian votes. You have that. Isn't that Asabiyah? Is that Asabiyah? So even the most advanced democracy in modern time, they have not done away with Asabiyah. All right. Just a little things about the applications of this theory of Asabiyah to the new Malaysia. This, of course, we can observe a lot of political ansabiyah in Malaysia. Right? It's a lot of ansabiyah. We have seen the decline, the rise of new ansabiyah, the rise of certain new political associations, political parties. Yeah, they will generate their own ansabiyah in due course. And then, of course, we are yet to see where the new coalition, the Pakatan Harapan, is going to be. How is it going to fare in comparison to Barisan Nasional? Is it going to be a better coalition for Malaysia's future? We will see. But it's interesting. In other words, it could be that the Malaysia is going for a two coalition system in which the Malaysians are given this choice, either to go for whatever is going, whether it's still BN or it's going to some new coalition to replace BN, I don't know, and the Pakatan Harapan. But we can see all this, we can observe some new differences in terms of approach to to addressing problems and dealing, there seems to be more openness among the members, even among the members of the Pakatan Harapan. As I said, it is still new, but if you are looking to Ibn Khaldun's theory for guidance, some guidance in terms to answer this, I think we need to look at the what happened really. The development of the UMNO ansabiyah over the last 60 years, how did it decline? What was the reason and so on? So Ibn Khaldun offers some guidance. So the clash, not of civilization, but the clash of ansabiyah, and the clash of ansabiyah in Malaysia, that is, can be studied by being guided by Ibn Khaldun's theory of ansabiyah. The idea of how a group within the same ansabiyah can rise to rule. For example, we need to go back to the book Al-Muqaddimah of Ibn Khaldun. We need to read Muqaddimah again. Those who are interested in it. And finally, I just want to say that to the question of what going to happen to Islam and democracy in Malaysia in the coming years, especially under the new government, I would say that, of course, it depends on the population also. What the Muslims themselves hope to do, but at the level of ideas, at the level of values, I'm saying that Islam can be a source of empowerment of democracy in the positive sense, that is, in the enrichment of common good as universally recognized. For example, now we talk about what is the common good between the Malays, the Chinese, the Indians, the Kadazan, and so on. What is our common good? Of course, for a prosperous Malaysia and so on. But I think we need to go deeper than that. To us, from the viewpoint of religion especially, I think our common good should go beyond this material good. Economy and so on. We need to go beyond also that diversity that in which, the, for example, we go for the things that bind us together in terms of values, in terms of moral values and so on. Because there are commonalities between all religions as far as these values. We share many common values, moral values as well as spiritual values, but we have also differences. How to deal with differences? And therefore, we need dialogue. So ansabiyahs must have dialogue with each other. I think that's basically what it is. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. And I'm back as a student. And there's so many points that I want to sort of send, but I will not abuse my position. Others first. If I have time, I'll ask. A lot of things that we can expand on. Yes. Anybody? If you don't, I come in.
Dr. Osman, a very interesting discussion. It stimulated me to, I can't sit down, I have to stand up. That's my style. It's very interesting. It stimulates my idea, the idea about Osabia. I think I agree with you. We have to come back, study back. Ibn Khaldun, it's been 100 years, but still relevant. I put in an argument. What is Malaysian Osabia, by the way? How to define it? How to pinpoint? Is it relevant to ask that question? Where is Malaysian Osabia? Is it political? Is it economic? Is it social? And another one is relevant to it is politically in Malaysia. Malaysia in between Singapore and Indonesia. Indonesia is a Muslim majority state. Singapore is a Muslim minority society. Malaysia in between, neither majority nor minority. We have about 55%. So with that, politically, Malaysia have the leverage to move forward, to chart our own Osabia thing, and then we have the leverage, not only in terms of permanent international relation, but as well in terms of theologically, I put it this way. I think it's a good idea, the political agenda of Rahmatan Lil Alamin, synchronized the very idea where Malaysia neither majority nor minority. So we are in between. So we have theologically liberate ourselves. We can move forward by experimenting new things. What do you think?
When can we have Malaysian Osabia? Is that?
Yeah, we are not melting pot, neither solid bowl.
I agree. Yes, we do need. Because so far, we have only Malaysian Osabia when we had a soccer tournament and against Indonesia or All England Cup, badminton. That's right, yeah. This is precisely the question of verse of the Quran that refers to the creation of nations and tribes, the idea of the ta'arufu, that we may know each other. Of course, the question there, Osabia is the purpose. Yeah, that Malaysia, our identity will be better known by others, and therefore it's something through all fields. I think attempts have been made. We have to be fair. Attempts have been made by all previous leaders to make Malaysia better known, more competitive. The idea there is competition. The concept of competition, healthy competition, tasabuk, the competition. We need.
Can you equate Osabia with nationhood, for example?
No, the question of Kemalaysiaan. What is Osabia means? Kemalaysiaan kita. What is it that bind us together as Malaysian?
So you mean basically like Pax Malaysiana, akin to the word Pax?
It's not identity. How can you have a Malaysian Osabia without identity? Each Osabia has his own identity. Language, having a common language. That is one of the elements that defines us as the Malaysian identity, right? So despite we, from different ethnic groups, and yet there are things that are common to us. I think that's now we have to build, we have to develop. It's challenges. Even the question of language issue now, for example, it's not yet settled after all this year. Nevertheless, the language issue is the national language is already settled, but it just takes a few people to raise negative question, then we somehow lost direction. So That shows that our Malaysian-ness, the Malaysian asabiyah in this context, is not yet mature.
I think I had raised my hand before them. This is another asabiyah. Prof, I was wondering whether in the formation of asabiyah, whether there was any correlation between Ibn Khaldun's theory of education and asabiyah.
Theory of education.
Yeah. He does, in a great length in Al-Muqaddimah, speak about education. And it is the system of education from kindergarten to, and specifically his emphasis is more not on the university level, but it is more on the primary and secondary education. That is where the formative phase of an individual is. So that I was wondering if that would be somehow helpful in terms of rising above, because at the end of the day, when you have that multiple asabiyah, like if you're Malay and then you're a Muslim and then you are a Malaysian, so you may rise above one to the other. That's why you sacrifice your being Malay for being Malaysian. And Malaysian, you would be sacrificing it for being a Muslim when you come in contact with others. But that is where education plays a role. I was wondering if you could comment on that. Thank you.
Yes, of course. Education comes as something important in Ibn Khaldun's overall vision of the role of asabiyah in civilization. Precisely, it is the failure of education that accounts for the decline of asabiyah. Yeah? In other words, what kept the asabiyah intact previously? Precisely because that transmission of values, transmission of beliefs from one generation to generation. Somehow, when that transmission is halted or is disturbed by what disturbed that? There are many things. The concern for the worldly things. You know what is the problem with civilization? The problem with civilization, according to Ibn Khaldun's theory, is when we begin to think about things which are not really necessary for us. Yeah. Not necessary. So, there is connection between continuity of asabiyah tradition. In fact, education is not simply to preserve what you already have, but also to acquire new ones, of course, what civilization means. So in one sense, you have a kind of paradox. The paradox here, that civilization can erase our tradition, or it can also enhance our tradition.
Because if a system of education is properly developed, the decline of the asabiyah, and therefore the decline of civilization, might not be that imminent if a proper system of education and if people are grown and they understand. So why, if you see, when Ali was asked why a prophet or generation was better or Abu Bakr generation was better than yours, because he said that he had followers like you, but I have followers like Ali. So the point I'm making is that the level of education, that the training that the people have, and the awareness of the values that you put it, the purposes, the commonness of the humanity, whatever it is, that if they have, so if that is maintained and preserved, when anyone else comes in and they're not aware, you know, when you say that the future generations are not aware of the struggle of the forefathers, for example. So at the end of the day, what will happen is the asabiyah would weaken, and when it weakens, it will lead to decline. So in a way, Ibn Khaldun is telling us that a civilization may even continue for 300-400 years. That's why dynasties sometimes could continue longer than the 120 years or 100 that we will say, two or three generations, provided. And that's what I think, at the end of the day, we talk about a moral system of individual system of government and all those things. And when the decline happens in the man, decline happens in the system, and decline happens in the entire. Thank you.
Okay. The observation, yeah. But we need to make a distinction between the rise and decline of dynasties and civilization, because within the same civilization, you can have different dynasties. That's why the Khaldun talks about how a dynasty loses power and paves the way for another dynasty. But the other thing which is very, very important to take note in the case of Ibn Khaldun, this is a question of, well, in a sense, it is something already predetermined, a kind of, okay, that when it talks about the lifespan, we're saying that every Asabiya has a lifespan. Not the Asabiya itself, but rather every group, yeah? Every group, every culture, every... that lifespan, just like it's like a living organism, we are born, we grow, and then we become old. That's it. So it's talking the same thing in the case of the rise and decline power, the ruling powers, for example. Ruling powers cannot be there for forever. It's subject. It is subject to this universal law, in a sense. The question of why are men, human beings, condemned to repeat? As they say, why are we condemned to repeat the past mistakes? When we know, if we know history, then we know this is going to happen. But it's true nowadays, of course, people don't care about history anymore. You see, the situation is even worse. We don't learn from past mistakes because we don't care about the history. We care only about the present. Okay.
Yes, thank you. Yes. But I just want to make one passing remark. Prof.
Sorry?
Just one.
Yes, yes, remark. Please. Yeah, you are.
Right. You see, Asabiya will have its time. It produces civilization. Asabiya is a mechanism. Civilization is a product. When this Asabiya has gone down and dead, what about the product? Will it be dead at the time of the Asabiya? Or will it be extended? After this, number two and number three. In other words,
yeah.
Now we have a new government, that Asabiya is gone. Will the civilization that they built, what is the stand?
You are talking about New Malaysia? No. If you say New Malaysia, my answer will be different. But if you say generally, that will be different. Eh? Yeah. So, no, you see, Asabiya as such will not disappear. I said already, the phenomena of Asabiya as a social phenomena will always be there. But the forms of the Asabiya, the types of the Asabiya, can differ from one period to another period. And the organization, the organism, the social organism that has a particular Asabiya, that has a lifespan. Let's say the Asabiya embodied by UMNO, for example. If you mean by that particular Asabiya, based on Ibn Khaldun, then that is not going to last beyond 90 years. That is considered that is the maximum limit. It could disappear much earlier under certain circumstances. But when it's when well before that period of three generations, if it appears, well, it disappears in the form, but it can come under another form. Let's say go back to the issue of this country. Let's say now the issue of UMNO and Bersatu. Is it possible, according to Ibn Khaldun, for in its UMNO form, the Malay Asabiya will disappear, but it will be transferred to another another form, which is bersatu. That is possible. I'm not saying that. As Osman Bakar says, it's possible. Ibn Khaldun, speaking for Ibn Khaldun, yes, according to Ibn theory. So, in other words, in the context of Malaysia, it is very well possible that UMNO, U-M-N-O, will disappear, but the Asabiyah that was espoused by UMNO of Zia, that could go to another organization. That's possible.
Thank you so much. So, regarding to Brother Jamal's question, I would like to further up question: how to relate Asabiyah to how to relate Asabiyah to nationalism and patriotism? I mean, how can we balance them in content?
With nationalism, with
patriotism.
Patriotism is an expression of nationalism. That's how we put it. What is the relationship between nationalism and patriotism? So, patriotism is a particular expression of nationalism. Nationalism can express in many different ways. And one way is patriotism. In terms of defending the love for the love for the homeland, for the watan, that which is for high purpose. I mean, it's not to serve an inferior ideology or something like that. No, it is something that is allowed by religion. That is okay. So that's why, for example, I know there used to be some Muslim scholars in the past, or some writing in the past, nationalism of any kind is haram. It's condemned by Islam. It depends how you define that nationalism. Yeah? But you're asking how to relate between the two.
And how to put them in balance.
There is no conflict between nationalism and patriotism. The issue is question how to balance does not arise. How can we balance nationalism, when they're already in a sense inherently connected, unless what you have in mind, what do you mean by nationalism? Is it the love for a country? That nationalism, that's fine. That's not against religion. The question is, you don't do things at the expense of the truth and justice. Nothing must go against truth and justice, not injustice. When the moment you do thing resulting in injustice on other people, that is not allowed by religion, by Islam. So Islam does not go along with that. So that's why it is correct for scholars in the past to criticize nationalism with the idea of nationalism that my country right or wrong. For example, right, my country right or wrong. That is not Islamic. If it is wrong, we must say, as Muslims, it is wrong. Yeah, I think that's important.
Professor, based on your thoughtful presentation about the new Malaysia regarding language, in this new Malaysia, I think it's a very good time to pay great attention to manuscripts, specifically manuscripts from Malay world and civilization. I'm talking about the new generation. While they are hijacking in front of our eyes, it's very good if we present this valuable manuscript. I'm talking about Javi manuscript, and train our new generation to be familiar with this kind of literature. For example, Hamza Fansouri, Professor Zeko, and I recently translate this wonderful manuscript, and I think it's a very, very good example to share with even primary or secondary students to teach them from this country, from this area, Southeast Asia, how Islam defined in this tradition. And I wanted to know how do you what do you think in new Malaysia we can use last and I mean ancient thought in new generation.
I cannot answer for you in the question what whether the new Malaysia government or administration is going to do what you expect. But anyway, the thing that you mentioned, I equate that with the pursuit of luxury. For academicians, it's luxury. I mean, it's not the luxury of the bankers, luxury of the, this luxury of the scholars. Fine, but our issue here is not a question of whether people will know Jawi. Although it was a part of the national of the Malay civilization, Malay identity in the past, but we are talking here even the national, the Malay, the Bahasa Malaysia itself is a question that is not fully addressed. How to ensure that every Malaysian will speak the Bahasa Malaysia, yeah? Apart from knowing other languages, that's it. Okay. What we want is that culture in which the factor that binds us together, one of which is Bahasa Malaysia, can be pursued. But beyond that, we want Malaysians to know other languages. To know other languages. What these other languages? That is not fardu ain. That is fardu kifayah. Based on the necessity, yeah. This is not choices, yeah. So it's good for Malays to know Mandarin, for example. To know, of course, English. Same thing. It's good, say, for the Chinese, you know, to know other languages. Again, apart from the Bahasa Malaysia. So I think it's a question of, it is part of Malaysian Asabiyah. It is part of Malaysian Asabiyah. Okay?
Thank you, Professor Osman. As usual, such insights. I'm very excited when I was listening to you, partly because I was asking a question from a Christian point of view. What would be, not the same words, but similar concepts that arise, and some came out were like in Catholic social teaching. I'm Protestant, but yeah. The Catholic social teaching talks about a version of solidarity.
Yes.
That seems to be a very powerful point of contact for us to move forward, to contribute to a Malaysian Asabiyah, yeah. So yeah. To speak. The other was, even if I go further back to the New Testament, there was this notion of koinonia. Mm-hmm. And in recent times, I think in the ecumenical movement or different churches, they talk about communion. I think there's differences, mm-hmm. but it's interesting whether these conversations could be part of our contribution to what, if I may borrow your term, an Asabiyah imagination. Mm-hmm. Probably that would be my... And I was wondering about your thoughts, because religion as a human phenomenon, can be abused in a sense of when it ties in with political asabiyah, when it's a religio-political one. I mean, let's go further, like Japan. People think it's very secular, but the politicians would need to pray to the dead from war, or Shintoism. So it's a, and now questions that arise in India, for example, the Hindutva ideology. So because religion is so powerful, it's a powerful asabiyah that binds us together. So I was wondering about your thoughts, because I think you are talking about there is exclusivity we can't deny that. But you are advocating a more inclusive kind of Asabiyah. And in Malaysia, I think this is very exciting because we do have a window of opportunity now, either in scholarship or academia, or building on Muhibah. I mean, what's the relationship between Muhibah and Asabiyah, for example? Would love to hear your comments because this would be very exciting for us.
Okay, thank you. Actually, we have dealt with the issue you have raised in a different context, in context of dialogue. Mm-hmm. I have been involved in dialogue for the last 40 years. Okay, 40 years. And I mentioned that an important goal in our dialogue is to arrive at a broader commonalities. When we first have dialogue, because of our respective ignorance, we think that that much we have in common. But after dialogue, we realize, oh, actually our commonality actually embrace a broader. Same thing with differences. We thought we are so far away from each other. But when we discuss and then have a dialogue, we realize, no, our disagreements actually are not that. Yeah? So that's very important. That's the approach in dialogue. How to strengthen our commonalities and how to respect our differences. So that was the context. Today, it happened that we are talking about in the context of Ibn Khaldun's and Sevilla. Yeah? But I don't think there's much different in terms of content. Basically, it's a question that in a society like Malaysia, where the different the religions live together, it only makes sense that we talk to each other and discuss about our commonalities. Our commonalities, say between Muslims and the Christians, just the two sides is different, for example, when we want to include the dialogue between Muslims and who don't believe in religion, for example. All right? One Chinese Muslim student from China studying in Malaysia has asked me, he said, how can you deal with the present Chinese government who wants to cynicize religion? Okay, no, basically it's to cynicize Islam, Christianity, and Buddhism. Surprise, Buddhism, because Buddhism has been there around in China for much longer than Islam and Christianity. But under the present government, partly because of the Tibet problem, so Buddhism is also under watch, yeah, under watch. So, Sprenger said, I mean, how can we talk about, how can we have a dialogue between Muslims and the communist government in China? And if you remember this morning, when Dr. Esposito talks about where the non-believers, I mean the atheists, for example, do the atheists have any space for dialogue in the national context? And he said, yes, if you understand, but we are limiting that to civic, to civic dimension, to the rise as citizen, not about their beliefs or disbelief, whatever it is. Yeah? But in the same case with China, for example, Islam, because Islam has something to say about social justice, so the subject of social justice can be a platform for dialogue between Muslim leaders, intellectuals in China, with the so-called Marxists in China. Yeah, they can talk. The Marxists in China talk about with the Confucian, for example. The believers in Confucianism, they don't talk about heaven, they talk about the spiritual thing, but they talk about social justice. So the same thing, and if it depends, I said, in Malaysia, therefore, it depends, you are talking to whom. So if Muslims are talking to Christians, for example, then different issues. If Muslims want to talk about Buddhists, different issues. And to talk to the Hindus, different issues. I mean, the social issue, or rather, even the religious issues, they're different. So the point is, I think as I said, we need an environment in which, by having this dialogue, we will not be accused of being jeopardizing Islam or whatever. No, you understand? Yeah. But I hold a position that dialogue, in this sense, is not meant for everyone. You know? Dialogue is for those who know the subject, and for those who are not afraid that their faith, their iman, will be undermined by having that. If you feel that by having this dialogue you're going to lose your faith, don't. Yeah? But don't prevent others from joining that. Yeah? I think that's important for example, I'm talking for Muslims, but let the people who have the knowledge, let them talk to the Hindus, to the Christians, to the Buddhists, to the atheists. Yeah? They're not going to become less Muslim. No. Yeah? But I will not, I must have not advised those who are weak in the Anderson region to do dialogue. No. But of course, I mean, we have both sides. In the Christian side, we have the evangelicals, for example, who go all out to. But I know we have a lot of things to do. Eh?
If I may just appreciate your comments. When I was in Sarajevo, someone gave a very interesting metaphor. We always think about building bridges as two sides, building bridges to one another. And that's one way of dialogue, understanding, as you have mentioned. But he said, how about looking at it another way? Actually, we are both on the same side, in some sense. We are trying to build a bridge to go across. And I thought that sounds like a kind of asabiya, where you are bonded together to work towards a shared future. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of a powerful metaphor.
My wish is that, for example, there are so many national problems. The weakening of the family institution, for example. The family institution is weakened across different religious groups. Doesn't mean that only Muslims have problems. So why not? Because we are interested in how to deal with the decline of the religious, with the family institution, but from a religious and moral perspective. And therefore, we have to talk a different language. And therefore, we cannot deal with the atheists, for example. But Muslims and Christians can talk on the subject. How best we deal with this undermining of the institution family by the modern development, modern civilization, all kinds of things. The media, the electronic media, and so on. Yes, I think that will strengthen our society, yeah, because we don't discuss this issue purely from the viewpoint of one, but as citizens of this country, how can we ensure that this is the same thing with crime, the crime problem? How can we deal with this? Yeah. But finally, as you say, the human dignity, the meaning of being human. What is the meaning of being human in the contemporary world? I think we're raising the bar. Yeah, we are raising the level there, because we are talking about how to be better human beings. And that's a very fundamental question. How religions look at the problem? How do Muslims look at this problem? How do Christians look at this problem? Yeah. And we don't, and this is an area sometimes we don't be afraid to learn from each other. When we live together in the same country, all along we learn from each other. So not only the Chinese food has already interacted with the Malay food, with the Indian food, and become Malaysian food. It's not simply that. It's much more than the food. Yeah.
Thank you for your pop-up.
One more question.
Is there still time?
No, but we make it a wrap.
Our sister there.
Yeah.
I raised my hand about half an hour ago.
You gave your position to her. Anyway, I will finish.
Sure.
Yeah, please.
Is it okay?
Yeah, please.
All right.
it's really a pleasure to see you back, you know, after so long time. I enjoyed your talk a lot, and I was having some thoughts about, you know, you clarify, I'm explaining whether I understood it well, that Asabiya is actually a pattern of multiple identities, multiple social and collective identities that they are not mutually exclusive, that could complement one another. Would that work out? Okay. So in that case, I think, you know, it's, as Ibn Khaldun put it, it's not something new, it has been there. Why is it now a problem? My feeling is that the growth is not organic. That means we have always had multiple identities, but now each identity has become so bold that it pushes the other identity around, and we are put in a position to choose between our Muslim identity or Malaysian identity or Asian identity, etc., etc., leave aside our professional identities. And this growth is because of the what I call a fragmentation of knowledge rather than the integration that used to be the tradition among all the religions, all the traditions in the past. So with this explanation, my feeling is that now moving towards all the names, we talk about democracy all the time, but we hardly talk, and you mentioned, about justice. Democracy is a form, whereas justice is that essence. Now we are, everyone is so much engaged to define democracy, and we are, whether we are democratic or not, that we would lose and become unjust towards ourselves and towards others, and still feel that, okay, we are meeting the targets for the democracy and ticket. It's happening to academia as well, whereas, you know, we are looking at our, we are measuring our fellow academicians by the number of their articles published where. And no one among our colleagues asks you, what did you write about? They ask, how many have you published and where? And if you let, they congratulate you heartily, and then they don't know what you're talking about. They know that you hit that target. They don't know what that target is, and they don't know about the content. So the form has become more important than the content. Thank you very much. It was some questions and some comments, but thank you for the opportunity.
Actually, it's just a comment.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I don't see question there. So I just, and I agree. I agree we are common, and then certainly that is one aspect of Asabiya that Ibn Khaldun discussed. Not the only, but certainly the question of course, multiple Asabiya. In other words, you have multiple Asabiya, that's not necessarily mutually exclusive. But otherwise, it's the same thing. That's why it's so relevant what he was saying to our context. But why are we engrossed in this? Why are we in problem now? Well, we are problem because when we have been told that Asabiya is against, we look at the blameworthy aspect of the objectionable aspect of Asabiya, then we have to address that. I think when I was invited by IUM to talk here today, I chose that topic. I thought that maybe it's a good time now to talk about New Malaysia, to talk this the problem from the perspective of Ibn Khaldun's Asabiya. Yeah.
Can we have just one final one?
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, Prof, you did mention previously that Islam is an inclusive religion, and I did agree. with that statement, but in your opinion, how do we cater for LGBT and feminist group? I mean, these groups that are against with Islamic teachings, codes and conducts, besides the story of Kaum Lut, to what extent shall we prove to them that the behavior is against the Islamic teaching, but it's not in line with Quran and Sunnah? It means that we need to prove to them that that is against Islamic teaching, but then the reason is not according to Quran and Sunnah. Do you get what I mean?
Yes, yes. Uh-huh. So you are not satisfied with Dr. Mujahid's answer?
Which answer?
Sorry? Oh, oh, yeah. It's not to answer this question. To be fair, I think we need to organize another talk. because all the issues, different issues are mixed, lumped together. That is how I see the problem. The right, the question, there are many issues. What's the meaning of the right? Now, what's the meaning of being the right as an individual? And the question of group right. I didn't talk at all about group right. In the context of democracy, for example. But there's another thing. Modern democracy just talk about the right of the individual right. We talk about human rights. But in Islam, there is also the question of group rights, the right of groups. When Islam gives certain rights, for example, to the Ahlul Kitab, that is as group rights. Islam grants group rights to the people of the book, not to individual, but to the people. Or if you, yeah. So now the question that is important. So especially now when you politicize yourself, you are aiming for, when you have the question of group. Now it's a question of being in the group, and therefore you must have the right to have association, the right, all the kind of things. So it involves a lot of things. As I say, to be fair, we need to discuss properly that issue. Yeah. It's the question of behavior. It's another thing. Yeah? What is the kind of behavior? What behavior are you referring to? Yeah. We assume. Everybody is involved in certain kind of behavior which is objectionable. So there's so much thing which is based not on true knowledge, not based on real thing, but based on sentiment. That's why you go on having clashes between the group. One group and the authorities, because it's just you don't meet a common ground. You meet a common ground. So what is the common ground? There must be some common ground that to come. That.
So
I'm running away from that.
So that would justify for another forum or round table, because I think ISTEC is going to look into using the language of rights to the language of responsibilities and rights as well. Mm-hmm. So, but that would justify for another calling for you to come back to Malaysia. We will do that. Yes. Before September, if it's possible. But otherwise, we can do it after September onwards.
But I did recommend to that was Sri Rector in the room there, the refreshment room. I said, and this is related to that. Sometimes there are issues that are related to other issues. Then when we try to answer questions in the wrong context, we never get the answer correct. How to pose the question in the right context. Okay. So we haven't talked about, say, the issue of gender equity. I recommend, rather than talks about the women, talking about women rights only, and they among themselves, and then the men don't talk about men's rights. Is it? Is that no?
Men,
no, men. Yeah. Yeah. But why don't we talk about that concerns everybody, which is gender equity. Gender equity, in order to discuss that, so men and women have to sit down and discuss. So that we don't go on organizing program to talk about women, only women present, but men are not there. Yeah, that's just not a wrong approach. So instead of talking about gender equality, which of course is cannot be the case, it's not equality, but it is, I know what you mean by that, but equity is better, is a better issue, gender equity. Maybe within that broader paradigm, later on comes the question of the LGBT. Don't discuss LGBT in a solute, with no context. Yeah.
Okay, so we've come to an end, and the MC is looking at me. But this has been a great discussion, and this is what we've been missing for quite some time. I mean, asking and discussing an input that is really academic, thought-provoking, rather than just giving polite questions. We're coming back home, back to what ISTEC was, where we, you know, grip the problem and expound it, not just asking for polite remarks and, you know, nice words. So welcome back, Prof. Soon you'll be here with us, and you're going to lead us, and we're waiting for more exciting. And I would like to thank directors, both of directors, to make it possible. And above all who are here, thank you for your attention since morning. And I think we can all be happy that our presence here was meaningful. So thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamu warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Thank you, Prof. Kamar Onya. Thank you, Prof. Dato' Dr. Osman Bakar. Ladies and gentlemen, to simplify everything, so we have a situation where one day seminar is alhamdulillah, but not enough. So we need more, inshallah. ISTEC will organize more programs like this, seminars like this. So now I'm inviting Professor Datuk Seri Dr. Zaleha Kamaruddin, Director of IIUM, accompanied by Professor Dr. Abdul Aziz Bergut, Deputy Director of IIUM, to hand over token of appreciation to our distinguished speaker, Professor Dr. Osman Bakar. Faitafaddal mashkura. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, now we almost come to the completion of our seminar. I'm on behalf of ISTEC administration, would like to thank Prof. Datuk Seri, Tan Sri's, Datuk's, ladies and gentlemen, all of you. Again, special thanks to Professor Dr. Osman Bakar for being with us until this late evening. Please keep in touch, ladies and gentlemen, please keep in touch with all our future programs. And I end here with salutation of Islam and salutation of Islam is salam. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Thank you. All of you, ladies and gentlemen, are invited to enjoy some refreshment. Please.